Amen. Thank you, Lana. If you stay here long enough, Matt, I'll have you preach. Okay. Merry Christmas. What a beautiful time of the year. We would sit around as our children were younger, all three of our girls, Cheryl and I, and do exactly what many of you would do, so indulge me. And it came to pass in those days that there went out a decree from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be taxed, and this taxing was first made when Cyrenius was governor of Syria. And all went to be taxed, every one in his own city. And Joseph also went up from Galilee, out of the city of Nazareth, into Judea, into the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of this house and lineage of David, to be taxed with Mary, his espoused wife, being great with child. And so it was that while they were there, the days were accomplished that she should be delivered. She brought forth her firstborn son, wrapped him in swaddling clothes, and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn. And there were in the same country shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were so afraid. And the angel said unto them, Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign to you. You shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly hosts, praising God and saying, Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men. Our Father in heaven, what a glorious already celebration it is in the name of Jesus this evening. Thank you for everyone that's come out in the name of Jesus. Thank you for the voices that have sung in the name of Jesus. Thank you for the instruments that have played praises unto your name in the name of Jesus. Thank you for your scripture that we have read, which declares and gives glory and praise unto you for what you have done. Here we are 2,000 years later, and it's still as beautiful and as fresh as it was that moment, that day, when Jesus, you came from heaven's portals and came to earth to be our Savior and our Lord. Thank you for the celebration of Christmas time. Thank you again for your love for us, your grace toward us. I pray that you just bless and fill each and every person with your word, with your message, with your name, Jesus, for it's in your name we pray. Amen. Amen. Christmas questions. Now you think, oh, you're going to ask me about how big was the manger? How many people came to visit? How many shepherds were there? Well, I thought this way. As I'm traveling 3 years ago, I ran into this magazine. How many of you have seen this? How many of you have seen it? A few, maybe? It came out in 2012. It was out in 2019, as it says, a reissue of Life's Classic Edition. Well, I was thinking that this week we're preparing for Christmas time and we're going to talk about Jesus. So then here I am in the store again, and they did it again. The world is asking this question. So I ask you, in the form of this English, but we will look in the Word of God here in a moment of the way it's said in the Word of God and Jesus Christ himself, but who do you say that I am? Who do you say that I am? Christmas questions, that's what we've got for us for the next few minutes. I just want to talk to you for a little bit. Now, I know that there's a lot of children here, and maybe they're the ones who know how big the manger is. I don't know, but I'm not going to ask you that. In fact, this is our first question up on the screen for you. I don't know, I've got a new person up there. Her Her name is Christine. Oh, that's right, she got married, so now she's Brogan. You were so much quicker when you were brown. I don't understand. Just kidding. They're coming. Oh, I got to spit. I got to calm down. Got to be nice. Come on. In the Christmas story, and this is what it's called, of course, oftentimes, whom was Jesus Christ to all those mentioned? I just read the passage of Scripture from Luke chapter number 2. So let me ask you, you need to help me out. Maybe you could look up on your devices. In the Christmas story found in Luke chapter number 2, whom was Jesus Christ to all those that are mentioned there? Anybody? So nobody knows. It's an open book test. Come on. Yes, go ahead. He's the Messiah. His name is Christ. He's Messiah. Yes. Savior. Okay, that's the end of the class. Gosh. God is salvation. Go ahead, Milt. Well, I don't know. That's not in that. Well, you're ruining the question here. In Luke chapter number 2. No, I said in Luke chapter number 2. You're going to sing Holy Night here in a little bit. You can come up and do anything you want when you come back. Yes, you are. Joseph was present. Mary was present. Present, or president, one or the other. Thank you. Hallelujah. Shepherds, angel of the Lord, heavenly host, they're all there. Who do they say that he was? Anybody? Go. Go ahead. Somebody stole your question. Your answer. Emmanuel, okay. What does it say in the text? Yes. He was a child. He was born a child. Very good. He's a baby. What else? Christ the Lord. So here we are. Do you think maybe he was a tax burden to Joseph? It doesn't say it in there, but you don't know. I don't know. It says here that the shepherds, what happened when the shepherds spoke? And it came to pass as he was, excuse me, I'll go a little further. It came to pass, as the angels were gone away from them into heaven, that the shepherds said one to another, let's now go into Bethlehem and see this thing which has come to pass, which the Lord has made unto us. For unto us is born this day in the city of David Christ the Lord. Right? But what did the shepherds say? They're the messengers. His Savior. Glory to God in the highest. They called him glory. They worshiped God and said, glory to God in the highest. It says this will be a sign to you. He'll be wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. What did the shepherds say about him? What did they say when they came to the manger? What did they say? Okay, everybody, you're going to read this tomorrow morning, and then you can text me an answer. It says, and when they had seen it, they made known abroad the saying which was told them concerning the child. And all they that heard it wondered at these things that were told by the shepherds. But Mary kept those things and pondered in her heart. And the shepherds returned. What did they do? Glorying and praising God. Who did they say that he is? They had something to say. Let me ask you another question. It says up there on the screen, in the circumcision story found in Luke 2, see, you need to get your Bibles out. You got your Bibles. Whom was Jesus Christ to all those mentioned? He has to be circumcised on the eighth day, right? Who were the two people that he met when, as a baby, at 8 days old, he met two people? Anybody? Anna and who? Good job. Simeon. Okay. And what happened there? Well, Jesus was brought by his parents. He has to be submitted. The father has to give the name. The name is Jesus, correct? So in the circumcision story found in Luke chapter number 2, whom was Jesus Christ to all those mentioned? Whom was he? Whom was he? You look in the notes right there. They're called Bible scriptures. It says something about what's going on here. You see them speaking about him. Do they not? Simeon, what does he say? What is he? Amen. He is the fulfillment of all prophecy. He's been waiting and waiting and waiting. What is he called to the nation of Israel? Begins with a C. He's the consolation. He is the consolation. He has been predicted and prophesied for all these centuries, and he shows up, and they look at him and say, this is the baby who is the Messiah, who is the one that's been prophesied, and he is the fulfillment of all of God's scripture right there before them at 8 days old. Now transport yourself back 2,000 years. How about the people in the temple? How about all these different people that are there? The Holy Ghost is there. I heard that he's present. He's the one who moved Simeon to go. Isn't that powerful? The temple people are around. Anna is around. How long has been Anna? She has been a widow for decades. You see, sometimes we have to look in the scriptures and realize that the people of that time were as overwhelmed as you are staring at me for a few minutes like this. But they're overwhelmed for a different reason. It's right before them. The miracle of all miracles. That the God of the universe came. Many Jews rejected him and they did not believe that it was him because they were looking for the king that was going to come and wipe out the enemies. But many, like Simeon, like Anna, were looking for this man named Jesus, the Son of God and the Son of Man. Emmanuel, God with us. So let me ask you this question up on the screen. In your salvation story, found in your testimony, who is Jesus Christ to you? Who is Jesus Christ to you? Shout out an answer. He's what? Redeemer, I like that one. What else? Healer, what else? Savior, what else? Master, Lord, what else? Father, friend, continue. Foundation, I like that. What else? Come on. Your rock, what else? The King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. He's God? You win the prize. Good job. Go ahead and put that next slide up there, Christine. Now, here's a serious question for you. I want you to think now for yourself and who you are with him. Is it possible that Jesus Christ is only a name, title, and characteristic to you? Has it become so, believers, that he is your Savior, Lord, but that maybe he is just that? Jesus Christ got a little bit more serious a little bit later on in his ministry. Luke chapter number 9, it says in verse number 18, "And it came to pass as he was alone praying, his disciples were with him, and he asked them, saying, Whom say the people that I am?" Remember that? Luke 9, verse number 18. "Then answering said, John the Baptist, but some say Elias, and others say that one of the old prophets is risen again. He said unto them, But whom say ye that I am? Peter answering said, The Christ of God." Now here's a good question for you. In the disciple story, right now, you're in Luke 9. Whom was Jesus Christ to the people right there that he was speaking about? He has been performing miracles. They have been watching him. He is telling parables. He's in his first into second year of ministry. He has been busy about people's lives. Look at the list of people up on the screen in the disciples' story. You think, okay, Luke chapter number 9. Luke chapter number 9, verse number 18. And it says there, "Whom say the people that I am, but whom say ye that I am?" The Life magazine. This isn't a quiz for you to get an A on in your exam for institute. It's not a cerebral question. Jesus Christ was asking a heart question. Whom say the people that I am? Who do they say that I am? Is it possible that Jesus Christ, and having their attention and knowing that all the other people that had come over and around him had really got to a point where when they said, they say that you're John the Baptist, they say that you're Elijah, they say that you're Jeremiah. That's what it says in Matthew's account. In Mark's account, it says, one of the prophets. Hey, it also says in Luke's account, right here, look at it says in Luke's account, right there. It says, hey, that one of the old prophets is risen again. That's what they were saying that the other people were saying about him. The King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, the Savior of the world. And Jesus asks the questions of the ones that are following him closest. He says in verse number 21, as I continue down through verse number 26, "And he straightly charged them and commanded them to tell no man that thing, saying, The Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected of the elders and chief priests and scribes and be slain and be raised the third day. And he said to them all, If any man will come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross daily and follow me. For whosoever will save his life shall lose it, but whosoever will lose his life for my sake, the same shall save it. For what is a man advantaged if he gain the whole world and lose himself or be cast away? For whosoever shall be ashamed of me and my words, of him shall the Son of Man be ashamed when he shall come in his own glory and in his Father's and of the holy angels. So I ask you," in our last question before finishing up, in the Christ of God story, remember, they called him the Christ of God. The disciples says, "You are," Peter, saying, "the Christ of God." The others said, "Thou art the Christ," in Mark's gospel. It says in John 6, "We believe and are sure that thou art that Christ, the Son of the living God." The disciples said that. It says in Matthew's gospel, "the Christ, the Son of the living God." Those that were closest to him, they were getting a handle on it. They understood. But let me ask you, whom did they say? Whom did Jesus Christ say that they were to follow? It says up on the screen in Luke chapter number 9, a favorite verse of mine, and it ought to be a favorite verse of a lot of us. "And he said unto them all, If any man will come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross daily, and follow me." Jesus Christ said to them all, "What is a man advantage if he gain the whole world and lose himself or be cast away? For whosoever shall be ashamed of me and my words, of him shall the Son of Man be ashamed." The Son of Man, the Son of God says, if you will be ashamed of me in that day, then I will be ashamed of you. So now we ask the same question in a more challenging way about Jesus Christ and who he really is to all of you. Go ahead. Whom say you that Jesus Christ is? See, a lot of you can just cerebrally answer that. And you did. You shouted out 20 or 30 answers. You said he's Lord. He's Savior. He's King. He's everything. He's Redeemer. He's Healer. Young Caleb, what did I say? He is God. You win the prize. Just for a few seconds. But let me just have you consider, as we finish, another question. Why is Jesus Christ? I said, first, is he? It's a yes or no. Now I'm asking you why. Why is Jesus Christ only a name, title, or characteristic to you? Is it possible that today you do not know him as Savior, though you heard that he's Savior? You've never called on the name of the Lord to save you, but you've heard that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever should believe in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. You've heard that. You've heard somebody tell you that. You've loved the thought of knowing that when I come to church, somebody's going to tell me about Jesus. They're going to tell me that I can be saved from my sin. I can be saved from eternity in hell as the punishment of my sin. The Bible says God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved, because we're condemned by our sin. The Bible teaches us that through the seed of Adam, over centuries, that by one man sin came into the world and death. Death came by that one man. But God knew that we would need a redeemer, that we would need a healer, that we would need a savior. And so he says, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. You can have eternal life. And you truly right now as a lost person may say, well, all these other people gave answers, and I know the same answers, but your religion will not save you. Your set of beliefs in yourself and a little bit of God and a little bit of church and a little bit of being a good person and a little bit of giving to the church and a little bit of good works. Not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his mercy, he saved us. He regenerates us by the Holy Ghost and gives you a new life. The Bible said, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. The Bible says if you would consider him, that he was obedient, he was meek and lowly, he was guileless, he was tempted, he was oppressed, he was despised, he was rejected, he was betrayed, he was condemned, he was reviled, he was scourged, he was mocked, he was wounded, he was bruised, he was stricken, he was smitten, he was crucified, he was forsaken, he is still merciful, he is faithful, he is holy, he is harmless. He is undefiled, separate, perfect, glorious, mighty, justified, exalted, and risen from the grave. Consider him today. Please understand that when I say he was, it's that he is today, all of that. Oh, I know that. That's nice. He did good. Even the Life magazine wants you to answer this question. Who do you say that I am? Who do you say that he is today? Who do you say that he is? I agree with you, young man. He is the Lord. Let me ask you a couple personal questions as I finish up. Jesus is the. There's no doubt about it. He is the King of Kings, then the Lord of Lords. He is the babe in the manger. He is the way, the truth, and the life, and no man comes unto the Father but by him. But I want you to consider today that maybe that's all that Jesus Christ is to you. He's a nice title, a nice name. He has good characteristics. I ask you, believers, that would answer in the affirmative, he is my. Maybe you would answer it that way today. It says up on the screen this. Maybe this will be the season of your life that Jesus Christ becomes my Savior. And if he already is your Savior, then how about letting him know how much you love him? The Lord is my portion, the Bible says. Let me read a few more. He is my maker, my well-beloved. He is my Savior, my hope, my brethren. My brother. He is my helper, my physician, my healer, my refiner. He is my purifier, my Lord, and my master. He is my servant. He is my example. He is my husband. He is my teacher. He is my shepherd. He is my keeper. He is my feeder, my leader, my restorer, my resting place. He is my meat. He is my drink. He is my Passover, my peace, my wisdom. You know what else? He is my righteousness. He is my sanctification. He is my redemption. He is my all in all. Is that who he is to you today? Then maybe you ought to tell him. And if you never called on the name of the Lord to save you, and all he is, again, is a title and a name and a characteristic, maybe it's time to turn from your wicked, rotten sin, your self-righteous and your pride and your belief system that's going to send you to hell, and turn to the only one who called himself the way, the resurrection, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. Maybe today, I'm going to pray, and my brother's going to come up and sing. And when I'm done praying and he is done singing, I'm going to wait up here for you. But I'll give you an opportunity to respond. So why don't you bow your heads and close your eyes? And why don't you just listen to the sound of my voice before I pray? Please, close your eyes, bow your heads, a serious moment. I talk to you believers real quick. Maybe this will be the season of your life that Jesus Christ isn't just the, but he's my. Believers, maybe this is the season of your life where things will change. Or maybe you'll fall in love with him all over again like you never have. That you will pursue him as he's pursued you, and you will care about him being my instead of just someone else's. He is yours and he belongs to you, and you belong to him, believer. Lost person today, lost. He's not my anything. He's a title and a name and a character with characteristics that are good. Let me just give you a way where you can truly call the name of the Lord. It's up to you, you and God. Just acknowledge that God sent his son Jesus, and you believe in Jesus today. You say, I'm going to confess that I have sin that I'm putting aside in my belief system, and I realize that my sin is going to send me to hell. I realize the scriptures say, for by grace are you saved through faith, not of yourselves, it's the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. And that the Bible says that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in thine heart that God had raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. You can call on his name right now. Father, in the name of Jesus, I just thank you for your word. I thank you for the power of Scripture. I thank you for the worship that we have had today in the name of Jesus. I thank you that you loved us so much that you gave your only begotten Son. And I pray for those that are considering to make Jesus Savior, that right now, in the stillness of their heart, that you'll get a hold of them. I know you're prodding, but that they would respond to your call upon their soul. I pray now, as we continue to worship, continue to praise and give you glory, Jesus, that we would declare as believers that you are my all in all. In Jesus' name, amen. Milt, come. Please stand to worship the Lord and give him praise.
Oh, holy night. Oh, holy night. The stars are brightly shining. It is the night of our dear Savior's birth. Amen. Lonely sin and error pining till he appeared and the soul felt his worth. A thrill of rejoices for yonder grace, a new and glorious morn. On your knees, can you hear the angel voices? Divine, oh, night. Christ was born.
When Christ was born,
oh, night. Divine, oh, night. When Christ was born.
Fall on our knees. Oh.
Christ was born.
Amen. Woo! Thank you, Milt. Thank you. Thank you. Amen. Thank you. Merry Christmas. Merry Christmas to all of you. Have a great Christmas day tomorrow. Have a safe evening tonight. Lord bless you and keep you. Be safe and enjoy your